Can I welcome everyone to the 11th meeting of the Education and Skills Committee in 2017? And can I please remind everyone present to turn their mobile phones and other devices onto silent for the duration of the meeting? We've had a change in membership to the committee since the last meeting. I was sorry to see Richard Lockhead and Fulton McGregor go, but I warmly welcome Clare Haughey and Ruth Maguire to the committee. Item one is an opportunity for those members to declare any interest relevant to the remit of this committee. Clare Haughey.
Thank you for your welcome, convener, and I'm looking forward to working with the committee. I have no interest to declare.
Thank you very much. Ruth.
Thank you. I would refer members to my register of interest. I was formerly a North Ayrshire councillor.
Lovely. Thank you very much. The second item of business is a decision on whether to take a number of items in private. Items 4 and 5 of this meeting are consideration of evidence and then consideration of a draft report on the children's hearing system, respectively. Are members content that we take items 4 and 5 in private? Thank you. The committee plans to consider further reports on additional support needs and personal and social education in the coming weeks. Are members agreed that we consider those reports and any future consideration of the children's hearings report in private? Thank you again. We now move on to agenda item 3, which is an evidence session on the IPPR's report Equipping Scotland for the Future, Key Challenges for the Scottish Skills System. The purpose of this session is to receive an overview of the skills system to inform the committee's work in this area. And I welcome to the meeting Russell Gunson, Director of IPPR Scotland, who now present the key themes and findings of the report. Russell, the floor is yours.
Thank you, and thank you ever so much for the invitation to come and speak with you today. As you say, my name is Russell Gunson. I'm Director of IPPR Scotland, and just for those that don't know, IPPR Scotland's a cross-party think tank based up here in Edinburgh for the last 18 months, part of IPPR across the UK, which has a history of over 30 years. Where this report comes in, so we have undertaken two reports on skills, and we will be undertaking a third over this next month. And what I want to talk through is this Equipping Scotland for the Future report, our findings, our process, and the next steps for it. And you have a handout in front of you that will help sort of follow as I speak. We worked with the Further Education Trust for Leadership, which is a cross-UK trust interested in further education and skills in developing Equipping Scotland for the Future. And what we wanted to do was consider the skills system in Scotland, the future challenges that it faces as far as we can see and as far as the skills system can see, and also outline some potential priorities for action. So action now that will equip Scotland for the future over the longer term. And this built on our June 2016 report last year called Jobs and Skills in Scotland, which considered Scotland's labour market from a skills point of view, the labour market and the economy, particularly since the crash of 07-08. And for context, in a way, that's the quantitative report, the numbers report, that partners up with this more qualitative work in terms of equipping Scotland for the future. So what did the Jobs and Skills in Scotland find? Found that the labour market has performed well in Scotland since 2008. We've had a large jobs recovery. Our employment rate in Scotland has reached almost unprecedented levels, almost back up to where it was. And in particular, youth employment in Scotland is a success story compared to the rest of the UK. However, we have problems around pay, around productivity, and around progression. So we're beneath the UK averages on all of those, whilst catching up on pay and productivity. And we also had some innovative data in terms of skills supply and skills demand. So we worked with a multinational US company called Burning Glass to get real-time data from the labour market in terms of skills demanded, and we matched that up to the supply from the skills system. And what we found that there was a big gap between what the labour market is demanding and what the skills system is supplying. And equally, over time, if you look ahead to projections based on a few things like demographic change, technological change, that gap may well increase. So that's the Jobs and Skills in Scotland report. In terms of equipping Scotland for the future, as I say, we built on that numbers report because we wanted to get an insight into what the skills system saw as the challenges it faces, and equally some of those priorities in terms of action. And so we undertook interviews, research events, focus groups, all under Chatham House rules with employers, with employees and learners, with the college system itself, and with the learning and training system too. And as I say, that gave us a really qualitative understanding of what we saw as the challenges facing Scotland. Now, on slide four, I'm not going to talk through all 10, but what we do is outline, as far as the skills system is concerned, the 10 future challenges facing the skills system. So included in there is funding, included in there is inclusive growth, the high skill business model, how do we develop that, how do we get employers to focus on that? And equally, demographic change is there, technological change and automation is there too. And I won't talk through all 10, but we can, by all means, bury down into more detail in any that you find of interest. And then we outline 6 priorities for action. So if those are the future challenges, those 10, what do we need to do now? What areas do we need to work in now in order to ready ourselves for that future? And I will talk through all 6 of these. So what we find from the skills system is that an outcome approach and a clear national purpose seems to be missing. Why do we have a skills system? What purpose is it for? And can we much better measure the outcomes that it's trying to achieve? Secondly, regional integration. So there's a cluttered landscape, actually, in terms of a number of different regional entities across the skills system. So there's regional colleges, there's regional skills assessments, there's skills investment plans, there's potentially educational regions over on the school side, there's youth employment regions, so on and so forth, all with different boundaries and potentially overlaps of people, but equally potentially not overlaps of people. How do we better integrate the system at the regional level? Equally, clarifying the roles of the system. So we have seen a drift in terms of the role, for example, of further education. It used to be very much a work-focused route. Now 75%, at least, of 16 to 24-year-olds are going on to further study on the back of further education. Now that is a really positive thing. Let's not in any way argue the opposite. But that does lead to a gap in terms of some of those work-focused routes. That's just an example. What are modern apprenticeships for? That's maybe clearer. However, the new graduate apprenticeships, the new technical apprenticeships might begin to blur whether that's an early or a pre-career route, or whether that's a topping up mid-career route. Co-designing a responsive skills system, how do we get learners and employers much more involved at that very micro level? So we have seen governance changes, particularly in the college side of things, that bring the learner to the centre of the system and the employer and employees of the system there too. But how do we get that right down to the local level so that what people are learning, how people are learning, is co-designed by learners and employers? And then flexibility was a key one. So how we have seen, and again, there's some positives in this, but a reduction in part-time, particularly the most informal parts of FE. We've seen a reduction in non-recognised qualification courses. But in doing so, we've seen a much greater focus on full-time learning. And that perhaps made sense on the back of a financial crash with higher levels of unemployment. But as we look ahead, does that make sense? Do we want to restrict learning opportunities down to much more full-time, or do we want to see a much more flexible approach so that people can study at their own pace based on their circumstances? And then lastly, the 6th one was around transferability. How can we improve the transferability of the system across learning setting? So the one that is most often talked about is articulation between HE and college and university. There's a clear problem in terms of recognition of prior learning in the college setting when it comes to applying to university. However, that's as much of a problem between FE, college and university, or between a workplace and the college setting, or between actually employer to employer. And if we look ahead to the future with demographic change and technological change, we're very likely to see people working for longer in many more roles, many more employers, many more careers. How do we make sure people don't go back to the start, go back to scratch when it comes to their learning as they move through that journey? So that transferability of learning is crucial. And how do you, in essence, build a career of learning rather than simply, again, going back to square one as you move? So those 6, an outcome approach, regional integration, clarifying roles of the learning routes, co-design, flexibility and transferability were the key areas that we saw as priorities for action. And that's where equipping Scotland for the future stops, in essence. It sets that challenge. For us, we take up our own challenge, if you like, in our next report. So the first 2 I've talked through, Jobs and Skills in Scotland, Equipping Scotland for the Future, they set out the problem. but the next report due early May, up until yesterday's announcement at the very least, was and will talk through the solutions as we see it, so we can start to get into some of those in discussion. In short, though, I've mentioned some of these already, but the mid-career learning gap, I think we can focus on and begin to look through some solutions there. That regional integration point, we'll see what comes out of the Skills and Enterprise Agency review, but I think there's things to pick up on the back of that review once we see what does come out. Focusing the skills system on outcomes and what should those outcomes be. We can, for us, it's around productivity, pay and progression, and we should clearly focus it on that. And then lastly, around the architecture of the system, and again, the Learner Journey Review, the Enterprise and Skills Agency Review will have things to say. On the back of that, there will be more thinking and more work to do. So I'll stop there in terms of 10 minutes, but I'm more than happy to take this wherever you wish to take it.
Okay, Russell, thanks very much for that. Julian, Martin and I were fortunate enough to hear some of that before at the cross-party group on skills. It was very useful, which is probably part of the reason why you were invited here today. I've got a question around the regional integration of the skills system. Had you heard suggestions in your evidence gathering about how that ought to be taken forward, and particularly the role of the regional developing young workforce groups in leading a coherent regional approach?
Yes, so in the evidence gathering we did for the Equipping Scotland for the Future, the big, I suppose, feedback was that there is a clutter. There is all these new regional groups. In and of themselves, they make a lot of sense, but when you look across the system, they maybe make less sense. So that was the feedback. So it was the solutions from the skills system themselves, depended who you spoke to. So I think often you can, I'm sure you get it here too, but you can speak to one part of the system and they think they've got it right and everyone else needs to adapt around it. So there was fewer solutions that came from the people we spoke to on that. But in terms of our thinking, looking at how you can much better align the skills agencies at that regional level, so SDS and SFC, they are at the moment funding provision that overlaps and that equally should at least be aligned with each other. How we can, at that regional level, get much better alignment between those two agencies and in terms of funding so that national priorities can be converted to regional need so that that can in turn be converted into meeting that local employer and learner demand.
I suppose the role of colleges as well in the whole developing young workforce in the regional system. How have you found that?
Yeah, so college, in a way, the colleges have faced reform that other parts of the system haven't. So you've seen mergers, you've seen college regions created, you've seen outcome agreements between the SFC and college regions, and universities do face those too. But other parts of the skills system haven't seen that, I suppose, that attention in terms of governance change and in terms of structural change. Now, you can argue that's for the good in some respects, but equally, I think there is a point, and it's why I think the Enterprise and Skills Agency reviews is good time, well-timed. There is a point when you need to say, OK, take a breath, let's look at the system in the round and work out whether it's coherent or not across. So to me, bringing much more alignment between college regions, between some of those other regional groupings, including the developing Scotland's young workforce ones, and see what makes sense to be brought together. I'd add city deals, city region deals into that mix too. Because what we want to do here is not increase the number of regional bodies, but we want to reduce and bring coherence, or at least, if not reduce, allow them to work better together.
OK, thank you. I was going to work through the six priorities in terms of questions, but what I think I'll do is I'll just open it to my colleagues, and then if there's any areas I haven't been covered either, I can ask you a question, or you can maybe cover it at the end. Liz?
Mr. Gunson, could I ask you very specifically about outcomes? Because I think you're right to focus on that as being a real priority. Could I ask you, in terms of the way in which outcomes are agreed, do you believe that there is any evidence to suggest that the process by which outcome agreements are made, whether that's in a college or a university or interaction between the skills agencies, is not functioning particularly well, or do you think it's not necessarily the right outcomes that are being agreed? Because they're two very separate things, and I think they would help us to understand a bit better where the issues are.
I think, so just for context, so there are outcome agreements, as you know, in place for colleges and universities. There's fewer or less of a focus on outcomes in the rest of the school system. So part of this is bringing that culture, or at least that attempt to bring that culture across the school system, in our view. So if you're focusing on outcomes, you should focus on outcomes across the school system, not just in parts of it. More directly, though, in terms of process and in terms of the outcomes. The process itself, I think, the statutory basis for outcome agreements is actually the widening access or the fair access elements. And as you grow the breadth of outcome agreements, the focus, arguably, is at least at risk of being lost. So I think it's clear for outcome agreements, are they too wide? I think that's the question. Or do we need to narrow them, get back to what we see as the biggest priorities for those that we're bringing underneath an outcome regime? To me, I think fair access absolutely has to be there. But for us, and this brings on to the more outcome focused, positive destinations are no longer enough. It's not ambitious enough in our view. So any job or any learning or training or education place isn't enough. To us, what screams out from the evidence is that we need to get underneath what we're hoping to achieve through that supposedly positive destination. So a school leaver that goes out into a low-skilled, low-paid job, whilst we have progression rates in Scotland that are very likely to leave that person in that low-skilled job for the rest of their career, isn't a success as far as we're concerned. A school leaver that goes out into a low-skilled job with wraparound training and provision or out into a modern apprenticeship, that to me is success because it is beginning to achieve those outcomes around progression, pay or productivity. So for us, narrowing them down, I think the process would be tested by then. It's hard to judge just now. And narrowing them down onto those three Ps of pay, progression and productivity with a cross-cutting widening access seems to me to be a sensible approach.
And that's all very, very helpful. I think the key issue, though, in determining what the right outcomes have to be is a matter about defining where the issues are. And you're very clear in your paper that it's not always easy to get good engagement with the groups that need to be involved in that process. And I just wonder if you feel that more has to be done to ensure that we're actually identifying the problems. You said in your introduction, for example, that there is a big gap between the demand and the supply in terms not just of numbers, but in terms of what is that demand and what is that supply. In other words, there's a bit of a mismatch of the skills. And you also flagged up the fact that there are concerns that sometimes we don't have enough flexibility within some of the provision, that we're not responding necessarily to local needs. Could you be a bit more specific? Maybe this is something for your paper that's coming in May or maybe a bit later. Could you be a bit more specific about how you think we address that? Because I don't think we're going to solve any of these issues unless we are very clear indeed about what the outcomes need to be in terms of the delivery of the skills and where the issues are.
Yes, and I think so. The original question was around outcome agreements. I think there's almost layers to this in my view. So there's a national objective that needs to be much clearer as far as the skills agencies are concerned. So what are we hoping to achieve in terms of outcomes for the skills system as a whole? You can translate that down to a regional level through outcome agreements. And yes, better engagement with learners, employers, more generally the economy would be useful in that. But in answer directly to that sort of secondary question around demand and supply and flexibility, I don't think you crack it at that national and that regional level. I think you crack it at the very micro level. So how do you bring those outcomes right down to the learner choices or indeed how do you bring tests of demand from employers right down into those decisions as to who gets a place and who doesn't and what provision a college or a training provider puts on? So to give you a very tangible example, modern apprenticeships bring that right down to, you have to have a job in order to be to go on a modern apprenticeship course in Scotland. There is a test of demand there in the sense that the employer is happy to engage and support you through that course. So there's an example of how you can bring in that route tests of demand and flexibility into that very local level. How can we do the same or an equivalent thing across the skills system? And for me, I think there are options there around testing that demand at the point of at the point of entry. So we've this is a little bit for the next report, but we've talked through the idea of a progression agreement. So the idea that in taking up a course, you agree through the three tripartite agreements between provider, learner, and employer, on the basis that the learner will achieve certain outcomes in their learning, the employer in turn will progress them in their career if they do, and in return for those two, the provider will provide the course for free. So you can see how building it right into that local level could be a way to bring tests of demand and supply to that local level and actually focus on outcomes right down at that micro level too.
My final point would be one that was raised in your event, I think it was in September that you ran your conference, when some of the employers who were present raised the issue about the supply side, namely that while younger people have some qualities that previous generations perhaps didn't have, particularly in terms of their adaptability with technology, there was one basic concern, and that was about literacy and numeracy of some of those who are obviously have the potential to be highly skilled, but that literacy and numeracy was a problem. Are you going to make some recommendations about what has to be done about there?
I think less so on the schools side of things from our point of view. So we do see the skills system as across post-16 education, including the senior phase of school. However, the reports that we've undertaken focus much more on that post-school sub-degree level. So adult education is sometimes what it's called, FE in skills. So less so in terms of literacy and numeracy in terms of schools. Where we do, and where I would, I was maybe a little more polite in the company that we had in September, but where I would push back a little bit is that employers do need to take some responsibility too. This isn't an absolutely a government or a skills system, publicly funded skills system responsibility, and it certainly didn't used to be. You know, it used to be the point where employers would take responsibility further up the pipeline, if you like, and get involved in schools, or if not, not expect ready-made workers there and then for them. So I think, yes, literacy and numeracy, a focus on it. You can see the government has a focus on it through the attainment gap challenge. It's less a focus for us, more actually the responsibility that employers need to take in terms of developing the workforce of the future. And there's some interesting, if not worrying, trends within the employer side of things. So we've seen reductions in investment from employers in recent times now. Things are tighter. You could imagine why pressures on budgets for employers are leading to cuts in training. But equally, you see patterns of investment that are a bit worrying. So if you're a high-skilled employee, you're twice as likely to have investment in skills and training from your employer than if you're a low-skilled employee. Now, if we're trying to achieve inclusive growth, if we're trying to improve productivity across those low-skilled, low-wage sectors, then encouraging employers to invest as much, if not more, in those people that do have skills needs is actually some, you know, an aim for us in the future.
Okay. Thank you. Colin?
Thank you, Ian. I was quite intrigued actually by pages 12, 13 and 14 of the report, and particularly by paragraph 3.3 on the future labour market. Demography has obviously been a big issue in terms of what's happening out there in the market. We've always had this big gap supposedly coming where all these elderly people would move out of the workplace and into the retirement homes. But in 3.3, you raised some interesting points in terms of how the jobs will change. But could you give us a little bit more information on that? And is there some optimism that those that are displaced by technology in the sort of mid to low skilled range, will they drift then into the what you call the absolute gaps that will appear in terms of the economy at that time? Does that seem a likely outcome? And how would you see these skills having to be developed and enhanced?
So there's two, they're very interrelated, but they are separate. Two trends happening, demographic change and technological change or automation. And they're very likely to hit us over this next 15, 20 years. So demography is one of those things that we can actually project and predict quite accurately, quite long-term into the future. immigration might change things a little, but actually only at the margins. So we do know that finally, what we've been talking about, or what it seems like we've been talking about for a long time in terms of the ageing population, already is hitting, but it really, really begins to hit in this next decade. So by 2030, I think it's roughly a third increase in over 85s. The proportion of the working age population drops, and the proportion of the non-working age population increases. So in terms of demographic change, it will happen. It will happen over this next 10, 15 years. And whilst it's a huge success and brings huge opportunities, actually, in terms of how we reshape our society and our economy, it brings huge financial challenges too. So that's the context, I think, within which we're operating over that period of time. Technological change is a bit of both. So if that's the pessimistic side, technological change is a bit optimistic and potentially pessimistic too. So on the optimistic side, in fact, let's start with the pessimistic side so that we can end with the optimistic side. Pessimistic side, around a third of jobs are at risk of automation over that period, that same period of time. So high potential risk of automation. This is through numerous reports now, Bank of England, PwC, and some academic papers across the UK and US. So this is a huge disruption, if you like, to the economy. And you can imagine so I think the figure is 2.5 million people are in the workplace now that will still be in the workplace by 2030. So this isn't going to be fixed by training new school leavers and school system leavers. This will have to be done by retraining people that are already out there. So that's the pessimistic. The optimistic, though, is that every single technological disruption in the past has also created jobs, and in actual fact created more jobs than it lost. People argue that it depends over what time. So over the long term that has happened, in the short term there's been disruptions that are more negative than that. But, and also optimistically, technological change can be the way we get through those headwinds, those demographic headwinds. So if we need more, in essence, tax revenue, more economic growth from fewer people of working age, then productivity has to be the way to achieve that. And technological change is one of our big hopes in terms of achieving it. So for Scotland to take advantage and embrace that opportunity, we need a skills system across the board that can also embrace that opportunity around technological change. So to get really specific on it, in terms of projections, we're very likely to see the human interactions of care, health, particularly those human interaction jobs that are related to older people, increase. Automation, though, is likely to hit, yes, low-skilled, yes, mid-skilled, but also new sectors that haven't been hit before. And the challenge there is to anticipate that change, to put in place a responsive skill system that can help people transition through that change, and thirdly, a skill system that can take advantage of the opportunities that come through that change too.
Looking at, again, paragraph 3.3, the second paragraph actually in that, you're talking about an existing fairly substantial gap between vacancies and potential applicants, and it's potential applicants, which is a very important word. That's quite a big gap to fill now. Is it likely, and this is probably a finger in the air, is it likely that technological advances are going to displace enough people to be able to keep pace with the demographic changes, given the fact we're starting from basically a negative situation?
Yeah, and there's so I can hear my colleagues, my friends over at SDS and SFC in my ear, slightly pushing back against the stats that we have for that. So the employer skills survey, for example, would show you that the skills gap is maybe there but smaller. Again, we've used new data that is real time, up to date. We can even tell you what it was happening yesterday in terms of demand in the labour market, and that shows a bigger skills gap. So reported from employers is smaller, much more quantitatively checked by us is bigger. So just with that caveat in terms of the skills gap, yes, starting from a gap now and looking ahead to not only a pattern that changes, so do we have learning in the right place? Are we producing people, for example, for our care system or for example, sales, that will be increasing over time? Or do we have the right pattern? And then secondly, do we have the right quantity? I would suggest on both, we don't have it right. So that, to me, suggests that we don't have a skill system yet that is responsive to demand in terms of pattern, and that we don't have a quantity coming through the skills system, including out into the employer work-based route here, that is ready to meet demand of now, never mind demand of the future. And some of this does come down to funding, and I'm not suggesting this all comes to public funding, but it does come back to the amount invested and therefore the quantity that we can get through. Again, technological change, and you allude to it, might help in terms of efficiencies here. So can you look at a blend of online and face-to-face learning that's quite, I suppose, new for the vocational route, which is much more focused on face-to-face physical learning for obvious reasons, because you're learning how to do things in a way that perhaps you can't do isolated from groups. But nonetheless, technology is changing all the time. There are ways now to do online learning that don't risk some of those sort of diminution in quality. So can technological change, just in that example, bring efficiencies that allow us to put the same, if not a reducing amount of money in, but get better outcomes, higher quantity, and a much more responsive skills system? And again, just to clarify, that isn't just public funding, in my view. That has to be employers taking responsibility too.
And elsewhere in your report, you did mention about employers being a bit slow to take up their responsibilities in that regard.
Yes, so there's in the next report we focus much more on employers, if you like, we're sort of tracking through the skills system. And there is evidence that across Scotland, across the UK actually, that employers are pursuing a low-skill business model far too often. So if you look abroad, one fact that's particularly stark in my mind is that around a third of the productivity gap between the UK and our international competitors is actually a gap that takes place in our low-wage sectors. So it's retail that is less productive than retail in Germany, wherever. It's hospitality that's less productive, for example, than the same in equivalent countries. And again, in inclusive growth terms, if we want to produce an economic model that narrows inequalities rather than widens them, you would focus on those areas where the inequalities exist, which is retail, which is hospitality, which is a good care and childcare too. So that's just an example of where the employer's business model is having an effect over our ability as a country to achieve the outcomes that we want to. And how we, you know, I'm not suggesting we force or we dictate to employers, but I think we need to encourage and show the benefits of changing business model for the benefit of them, but also for the benefit of the economy as a whole.
Thank you. Daniel, you wanted to come in with a supplementary?
Yeah, so I mean, technology change, I think, is a really important aspect of what the skills system needs to develop, both in terms of the technology skills people will need to acquire, but also it's going to change the way that they're employed, much higher levels of self-employment. Strikes me that the skills system at the moment, based around full-time college places and apprenticeships where you have to have an employer, aren't terribly well suited to self-employment. Have you given any thought as to what needs to happen in the skills system to help people sustain self-employment and also access training while they're self-employed?
Yes, and it's an issue for small and medium enterprises as much as those self-employed too. So the ability to access the skills system diminishes with the size of the company, in essence, or the employer. So this is an issue on a spectrum, if you like. And modern apprenticeships in their current setup are very good at accessing larger businesses, those that have the administrative capability to cope with employing and looking after an apprenticeship throughout their framework. There are ways, without having to restructure that, that you can begin to make it more accessible to smaller or even self-employed. So in way back, actually, 20 years ago in the oil and gas sector, you found a pooling, if you like, of apprenticeships or apprentices in terms of their employment. So rather than one company employing, there was a few that pooled together to employ. And that, I think, you know, we can go back in time and try some things that worked in the past that may well work in the future. But more generally, in terms of more casual work, self-employed, smaller businesses are on that spectrum too for me. I think you also need to look at a new route that is to the side of modern apprenticeships that begin to plug that mid-career gap for those very companies and for those very employment structures that has a much lower hurdle, a much lower barrier to entry, if you like, so much less administration, much less risk for both sides, and that allows a work-based route that is really tailored for that that future that we are facing.
Thank you.
Can I ask about the points you're making on earlier on about integration? The paragraph you've got, or the sentence you've got on page 19 of the report on the skills system integration is the closer integration and collaboration of skills agencies, etc., etc., etc. Integration means bringing them together, doesn't it?
In our view, it needn't. So, in our view, I think the Scottish Government's been quite clear. The consultation feedback's been quite clear in terms of the skills and enterprise agency review. That all four, I think, and that we may have a fifth one coming of those of those agencies will remain in their current structure. There may be a strategic board above, or there will be. For us, structural change could help, but actually it's as much about behaviour between those agencies. And for us, it's less at that national level where the debate has been to now, and more at that regional, if not local, level. So bringing them together is one option, but again, I don't think you need to do that in order to get the benefits of that integration and alignment.
Okay, so integration in that sense doesn't mean bringing them together. You're arguing against that.
I'm quite ambivalent on that.
Yeah, so okay. Can you give me some specific examples of what needs to change to make this integration happen?
Yes.
Because to be honest, I've read lots of reports over lots of years saying integration.
Yes.
And yours is the latest of many reports in the same theme.
Yes.
And why is it so difficult?
I have a phrase at the start of most events, which is that old ideas aren't necessarily bad ideas, but yes, and I think in terms of why is it so hard? I think you do have very different types of provision. So you do have training providers out there in terms of SDS predominantly funded that have a very different setup to colleges or universities in terms of what they're teaching, how they're teaching it. And therefore, if you're trying to get to outcomes for both, you'd actually probably approach that in a very different way. So integration of both is quite tricky. And also, where do you draw the line? So do you integrate FE and what we've commonly called skills and modern apprenticeship training and learning? You can make a case for that. If you integrate that, though, what about HE in college? You can make a case for that. And what about university, therefore? You can make a case for that. And what about schools over at the other end? All of a sudden, you've got a one agency covering senior phase of school all the way through to postgraduate university levels, and that brings its huge problems too. So I think, in being frank, that those are some of the issues. And then being frank too, you've got agencies that have interests, and you've got government that have interests, and you've got MSPs around here that have constituents with interests too. So that's why it's so hard. But I suppose the point I would make is that focusing on the governance and the architecture is one element, but it's only a means to an end. The end is getting to some of these outcomes-based approaches, and you don't need to restructure in order to do that. And sometimes, again, you will know this more than I in the time that you've spent here, but sometimes restructures can distract from getting to that end.
Do you think the skills review is doing a lot of distracting right now? But anyway, that's a...
Well, we had a report imagine. On that. Just
yeah, exactly. The other one I wanted to ask you about, Developing Scotland's Young Workforce, Ian Wood's paper, probably the one piece that I have read over all those years that was very clear in its recommendations. Why don't we just concentrate on doing that and nothing else?
Well, yeah, so...
Because that is very clear, and employers are involved, and you actually, I couldn't quite work out whether you were saying those employer-led boards were good or bad. I couldn't decide what you were saying earlier on, so maybe you could clarify that.
Yeah.
But, that is a piece of work that has cross-party support, it's well-led, it's ministerially driven, that kind of thing. Shouldn't we just try and get something right? Because it starts at the school, it's your point about micro, and it goes, I invert your pyramid. I don't start from national priorities, I start what's going to work locally, and that'll help people, because that's how it should be. Isn't that the thing we should concentrate on?
So are they good or bad? They're doing some really good work in and of themselves. So if you focus, as the question would suggest, just on youth employment or on tackling youth unemployment, they're doing some really good work. Certainly some are stronger than others, but still, this is new. I think the strategy is good. So Ian Wood's paper is good. In my previous role at NUS Scotland, we were involved in that paper through a representative on the commission. So I think it's a good strategy, and you're right, it has cross-party buy-in, which actually is a really strong part of it. So in and of itself, it is strong, but if you start to look across the sector as opposed to just in that sort of vertical snapshot of youth employment, suddenly you start to see where it could integrate better, I use that word again, with other parts of the system, and where potentially having regions for youth employment that don't match up to regions for schools, if we go there, that don't match up to college regions, et cetera, et cetera, can lead to some inefficiencies in the system and some missed opportunities. So in and of themselves, I think they're good, but in terms of coherence across the system, I think we can do better than that. Should we just focus on youth employment or stroke unemployment? I think we have to focus on it. I don't think these are either or things. And it almost brings us into this lifelong learning versus young people debate, which I also think is a false dichotomy too. We have to focus on youth employment, but we cannot just focus on it because of some of the things we talked through. So 2.5 million people are out in the workplace already that will need to be helped to transition to the economy of 2030. Focusing on youth employment won't help with those people. But equally, if we lose focus on that, we'll be storing up problems for later too. So unfortunately, it's one of those ones where we need to focus beyond youth employment. We need to focus across the range without also losing focus on that really crucial issue.
You well know and understand, because you're involved, that Ian Wood's report's much broader than just youth unemployment and youth employment. It's also about young people and the learner journey and so on and so forth. But my point is, if you have one agreed strategy, get the rest of it to work in around that and deliver. I mean, I take your wider point about adult employment and the changing workforce and 50% of people doing different jobs in 15 years' time because of artificial intelligence and robotics and so on and so forth. I totally get all that. But my worry about all governments is that strategy, endless strategies, lots of reports like yours that come out, there's never any long-term focus on one issue.
Yes, and I could understand. So in terms of implementation, focusing on one issue, a narrower issue, albeit a wide one. Yeah, a wide,
absolutely not narrow.
Yeah. No, sorry. A narrower issue, though, than the whole thing.
Yeah.
Focusing on that has its advantages, but I think there is a risk you'd be dropping the ball in other parts of the system if you did that.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Gillian.
Thank you, Convener. I'm kind of crossing into the other committee that I'm involved in as well. I'm in the Economy Committee, and we're looking at the gender pay gap. And that's thrown up quite a lot of evidence around gender segregation in particular sectors, which could be a potential problem in terms of skills gaps. I mean, namely, I think I won't be surprised that I'm mentioning construction, engineering, and the care sector as well. And these are all areas that are under a little bit of stress, particularly with Brexit approaching as well. And we need to be looking at how we can have perhaps more women and girls coming into the construction sector, and how we have more men going into the care sector in order to be able to sustain these sectors. And I wonder, there wasn't much mention of gender segregation in this report, but I'm wondering whether or not that's something that you're going to be looking at, because that has been flagged up as being one of the potential skills gaps that's problematic.
Yes, and I think both in terms of gender and in terms of socioeconomic factors, actually, the areas where we need to work in terms of increased pay, increased productivity, increased progression are dominated by people that are from poorer backgrounds or women, so care, retail, hospitality, etc. They're low pay, but this is a gendered low pay sector, I would argue. Now, I'm conscious I'm a white man, so I don't want to get entirely into it, but as far as I would, because there are other people, women, that could speak much more strongly than I on this, tackling these low productivity, low pay, low progression sectors is a gender issue as much as it is a socioeconomic issue, and as much as it is an economic issue. So if you are trying to get higher productivity rates from a narrowing, smaller working age population, you just, from an economic point of view, can't afford to leave whole chunks of the population behind based on gender or others, never mind on a social justice issue. So inclusive growth, to me, has to include tackling these gender segregations, but also these social class segregations too.
That does have an impact on what you've been talking around about employers getting involved in schools as well, because it really is starting at school age where you're maybe wanting to encourage either gender to go into a sector that is traditionally gender segregated as well. So are you going to be looking into that in the next report and solutions around that?
Less so in this next report, but it is absolutely something to take on from this next report, I think, whether us, whether others. And there's two approaches. So it's you're right, getting in very, very early with education, aspiration raising to some extent, but more linking those aspirations that I think do exist to how do you do it, you know, navigating that system, so information, advice and guidance. So getting, again, one approach is to get more women into sectors that currently don't have. Another approach, and you have to do both, I think, again, is to take those sectors that are gender segregated, particularly low paid, where there is injustice, and tackle that issue at the same time. So this is whether it's construction, whether it's engineering, whether it's actually, I'd focus as much on digital and new technologies too, which is by 2030, the timescale that we're looking at, likely to be an even bigger part of our economy. How do we get women, how do we get people from poorer backgrounds into those routes? Yes, but secondly, those routes that are currently dominated by people from poorer backgrounds or by women, care, retail, etc. How do we improve those routes in terms of pay, progression and productivity too?
And I mentioned the issue of Brexit, and I want to know how much that informed what you did in this report, because obviously that is an issue around, there are already gaps in terms of the people going into certain sectors. The care sector particularly has got an issue with recruitment, health sector as well. How much has that informed your thinking?
Yeah, so this came out in earlier this year. So the field work, if you like, for the report was pretty much started as the vote came in June last year. So it was certainly on the minds of people in the skills system, and it's certainly on our minds in terms of how we respond. There's a few factors in terms of Brexit. So the first one obviously is around skills gaps. So if you in those sectors you mentioned and others are going to have fewer people coming in from the EU or outside of the country more generally to fill those skills gaps, then that is a short-term issue that needs to be tackled for those employers, but there's a long-term issue there in terms of how do you train people up within this country to meet that gap. So that skills gap issue would be the first one, but equally there's the wider economy issue too. So if Brexit is a headwind on the economy that we'll be facing over that time, demographic change, technological change, that are also headwinds, then it affects our ability to, whether it's employers or government, to invest in skills and to invest in training. So in a way, it's a double whammy in terms of Brexit. In terms of opportunities from Brexit, we're less convinced that it brings the opportunity in and of itself to train up people domestically, and this is a good thing. For some of the reasons we've talked through, it isn't as simple as saying people from outside of this country have been allowing employers to get away without investing in training. It's not as simple as that. So the opportunities there, I think, are maybe overplayed, and I think some of the challenges that come from Brexit hit both in terms of the skills gap, but also in terms of the economy more generally too.
Thank you.
Thank you for that. And now we have Ross Thompson, whose intervention couldn't be better timed, I suspect.
It's not on Brexit, though there are many opportunities. Right. My question is round about priority five, which was improving the flexibility of learning. And in your presentation, you referred to it as key. And you touched on the reduction in the part-time places for further education. Now, my understanding is that part-time courses have between 2007 and 2016, so it's a 54% reduction that there's been. And as you said, you don't want to restrict opportunity because you need to ensure that there's the balance for those who want to work and study. So you posed the question, actually, in your presentation of, does that make sense? So I want to ask your own question to you. Does that make sense? And from your own evidence, what is the impact of that reduction been?
So I think the reduction, just to get underneath it a little bit, it predominantly comes, but not entirely, but predominantly comes in very, very short courses and also non-recognised qualifications. So very, very short courses are less than 10 hours in their entirety across potentially a year. And non-recognised qualifications, there's some really good things in there around access qualifications, but there were also some less good things in there that would have allowed people to train up, but not necessarily take that training to another institution or indeed out into the workforce. So what we've lost isn't by all means as simple as saying you know, we should get that back. What we're saying is more general than that, in that if you look at some of the, so if you're in a multiple career, multiple job, a longer working life scenario, what you will need will change throughout your year. There'll be points in between jobs where you need really intense bursts of learning. There'll be points when you're in a job where you need very sort of low frequency learning alongside your job. At the moment, it doesn't seem like we're set up properly across the skills system to cater to that and everything in between. So it's not quite as simple as saying we need more part-time, and certainly not quite as simple as saying we need to get back what we've lost over that 10-year period. What we do need to do, though, is allow flexibility so that employers and learners can get short bursts all the way through to very long, low-frequency learning and everything in between to suit their needs, because we're going to need that in the future that we're going into.
If you don't mind, what does that flexibility look like? I hear, I understand what you're saying, you know, short bursts, that flexibility, but so I'm clear in my mind, what does that system actually look like?
How
does that
so function? There's some examples in the system already. So CodeClan is a really interesting example within the coding industry. They, in essence, provide a 16-week, really intense burst of training for anyone who has a degree of any sort, pretty much. They do, I'm sure, have very strong admission systems too. But a degree of any sort, you need the aptitude rather than the qualification before you come in. And by the end of the 16 weeks, you will be trained up to be a coder. And they have really, really high employment rates at the other end. This is a real skills gap sector. We didn't have enough people within Scotland who had those skills. We've responded to it with that. So that's over on the very intense end. Another example that's out there in the system just now within Haughey would be the Open University. So it's a very modular approach. You can study at full time. You can study all the way down to, I think, 30 credits, which is about quarter time. And in doing that, you can build blocks of learning at your own pace and in your own interests and your own capabilities that allow by the end of it to have an open degree that is built by yourself. So those are examples that are out there just now to give it some, to make it tangible. Taking some of those principles and applying them much more to either, in the case of CodeClan, across different sectors, or in the case of the Open University, across other parts of the skills system, could allow you to take some really good practice that we've developed in this country and extend it across the whole of the skills system. And that, to me, would much better suit the future that we're going into rather than trying to sort of get back what we've lost over the last 10 years or so.
Okay. Thank you. Ross Gray.
Thank you. There's a lot of really positive stuff in this report, particularly the issues around automation that I'm interested in, but I can't help but feel, is some of this not working with one hand tied behind our back in the absence of a coherent national industrial strategy to dovetail with?
Well, so in terms of national industrial strategy, we have, in essence, an industrial strategy through the Scottish Government's economic strategy. Now, I'm not here to sort of review or comment on the Scottish Government's economy strategy, but it sets out certainly a vision for the future. It sets out some priorities within that. I think where the focus probably should be is on implementation of those priorities. So I'm not sure we lack an industrial strategy. It might be one that you or others don't agree with, but I'm not sure that we lack one per se. What we do need to focus on, though, is the implementation of those things. So if it's inclusive growth, if it's innovation, if it's internationalism, then what do we do underneath that in order to deliver on those eyes? Inclusive growth for us is a focus, you know, it's one that we do support, and I'm sure it's one that would gain quite a lot of support across the political spectrum. Delivering sustainable growth that is inclusive and that narrows inequalities rather than widens them. It is getting a little bit onto motherhood and apple pie, you know, who would disagree with that? But on the other hand, I think that's absolutely the right aim. And if we can crack it in Scotland, then we'd be among the first to do so. Some, you know, it's within that lens that we're operating with the skills system work. How can the skills system be at the centre of driving that inclusive growth, in essence, and delivering on that economic strategy in a way that actually has an impact on the ground? And for us, some of these ideas are really focused in that territory.
I suppose I should have said national is a relatively politically charged term these days. I was referring to a UK-wide industrial strategy. Even with the criticism I might have of the Scottish Government strategy, they are relatively limited by the powers of devolution, and a UK-wide strategy is required. On the automation point, though, it's been covered quite a bit already, but a lot of the public policy debate around how we deal with automation and potential job losses has focused recently on the social security response. We've got a couple of local authorities now who will be trialling universal basic income, and for a range of reasons, but one of them is part of combating that automation agenda. How do we ensure when we're looking at an issue like this that it is a joined-up approach, that we've not got John Swinney taking an approach on automation, Keith Brown taking an approach, and Jean Freeman taking an approach in three different siloed areas?
Yeah, and I think, sorry, just on the UK-wide point, I think that'd be a fairer criticism in terms of the UK government for now. They are developing more now, I understand, from colleagues in the rest of the UK. In terms of automation, I think, so the third figure, so there's almost a utopia and a dystopia when it comes to automation. So either we're going to be, apparently, all with our feet up, no matter what, either way, either in a utopia because the machines are doing the work for us, and we're willingly and happily allowing them to do it, or in a dystopia because they're doing it and we're not getting any, you know, we're slaves to the machines. I'm not sure I buy into either of those at all. I think we're much more likely to see change than we are sort of annihilation of jobs. So I think it's much more likely to take engineering, take car engineering. You know, it's already happening to some extent. A mechanic needs to know how to operate a computer as much as the traditional tools of the job. So there's an example of how automation is changing that role as opposed to eradicating it. Secondly, we have, at least for the demographic change periods of the next 10, 15, 20 years, attrition, so replacement demand, if you like. As the ageing population retires, there will be, even in contracting sectors, new roles for new entrants. So even if automation reduces jobs, that doesn't mean it annihilates opportunities for young people to come into those jobs. So I suppose that's context in terms of the universal basic income, in terms of more of a sort of cross approach to automation. Whether we need to go as far as such things, we'll see. But again, you can hear I'm dubious that we might need to go as far as a wage for everyone. There may be other reasons to do it, but it may not be automation. In terms of that cross approach, that connected approach, I think that's absolutely right. And I think setting out, you know, as far as the skills system is concerned, setting out those national objectives, those national outcomes that we wish to achieve, and trying to ensure that this goes across portfolio as opposed to is seen as the Minister for Skills or the Minister for FE and HE is crucial, I think. So I back that. I mean, how you do it is almost back to Tavish's point, which is we've talked about this for a long time. We need to begin to achieve it sooner rather than later.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Clare?
Hey, Convener. I'm keen to ask a little bit about transferable skills. And you mentioned in what you found future challenges, number 5, encouraging employees and learners to upskill and progress. But then in the priorities for action in number 6, you talk about the increasing transferability of learning. And you'd mentioned that there were some barriers to that. Could you maybe expand on what you saw the barriers were to transferring that learning?
Yes, so the articulation is the one that people focus on quite rightly, quite often, which is, again, people moving between HE and college with an HNC or an HND to university and not having to go back a step or two. So transferability, in that sense, there's some quite old issues there, but there'll be some quite new ones coming, I would guess, too. So the articulation between HE and uni is an old issue. I think an old issue that hasn't received much attention is actually FE straight to university. So, you know, on terms of the levels of learning, FE learning, non-advanced learning, can reach just as high as hires. It can be hires, actually. And yet school leavers have much more breadth of choice than a college leaver does with a same level qualification, which doesn't seem, firstly, efficient, secondly, right, or maybe you could put that in the opposite way round. The new transferability issues coming, which already exist, would be much more out into that distance of time. So if you are learning throughout your career over potentially a 50-year career, How do you ensure that learning from 10 years ago can be updated and taken with you as much as learning that's much more recent than that, firstly? Secondly, in terms of learning in the workplace, whether informal or formal, how do you ensure that that's recognised by your next employer, or indeed if you go back into the school system, by an institution? So that transferability gets a bit sort of greyer, if you like, in terms of the future that we're going into. There are some examples out there that we're interested in. So in Singapore, there's a workforce qualification that allows a modular approach. You know, we talked about this with Ross's question. It allows accreditation of prior learning, informal or formal. It allows flexibility in terms of really full-time down to really part-time. And using that as a basis, I'm not suggesting it's something to transplant to Scotland, but certainly something we can look at and be inspired by, as a way to allow that transferability within the workplace could be a really interesting thought. It's certainly on our mind for this next report.
So do you think then, from what you're saying there, that these the skills that have to be transferred, there has to be some sort of recognition of those skills, a sort of formal recognition of those skills for them to be transferable between workplaces or educational establishments, or do you see another way of doing that?
Well, again, employers can informally, you know, they wouldn't be, you would guess, you would argue, be doing their job properly if they weren't understanding the skills that their employees held, informal or otherwise. But we do have a skills, what's called skills utilisation problem, in that around a third, I think it is, of employees in Scotland have qualifications, formal qualifications, that outstrip their current role. So we've got actually a really good record in improving the skills levels within our population. Where we're beginning to see a problem is in employers using those skills in work. So it could be informal, it could be formal, but we have a utilisation problem even of formal skills. You would guess that there may well be a similar equivalent problem for informal skills if employers are not in the mood of looking at how they can stretch their employees in terms of the role, and more looking at whether they can do the role that they want. So to me, I think it could be either. I think formalising it could be helpful to allow that sort of passporting of learning across different employers.
And if you'll indulge me, just one more question, Convener, and can we anticipate, and I know I'm asking for a sneak preview here, can we anticipate that you're going to look at some of those issues in your next report?
Yes, absolutely.
Joanne?
Thanks very much. I want to go back to what you said, or two things that you said. One was the question of positive destinations, and the other was the question of part-time courses in college. I mean, my view of the decision on part-time courses is they've accidentally possibly got rid of some courses that weren't of much value, but by deciding on a crude decision around part-time or full-time, they've got rid of a lot of other courses that were particularly valuable, and I don't know whether you've done any work in that. I suppose the question I would ask is, do you think there's a tension between the needs and rights of people to access education and the needs to have a skills strategy that meets the employment needs of our economy?
So I think on the, I mean, I couldn't comment as to the intentions in terms of part-time. You know, where we've ended up is that I think you're right, there are some valuable that have been lost, but there are also some less valuable courses that have been lost in the reduction in part-time. Equally, I think it goes beyond colleges for us, so we're looking at the school system as a whole. So can you do a modern apprenticeship in a flexible way as much as can you do an FE or an HE course in college in a flexible way? In terms of that specific point, is there a tension between access and our economic needs, if you like? I think for us, you have to align the two. So if 2016 tells you anything, it tells you that if you don't look after the levels of inequality of whatever, of income, of wealth, of power, and if you just focus on economic growth, that begins to bite back over a certain period of time. And never mind that, much more within our worldview, if you like, it's a just thing to be doing, to be looking at narrowing inequalities and growing the economy, not seeing them as distinct from each other. And I suppose it comes back to the point earlier around gender and around socioeconomic or people from more deprived backgrounds. If you're going into a world where we need to get more from fewer people, to put it bluntly, in terms of getting through demographic change, in terms of getting through Brexit and whatever else we face, then you can't afford to have, you know, what are we talking, 20% in terms of socioeconomics, you know, a proportion in terms of gender. You can't afford to not be getting the most out of that level of people, that level, that proportion of people. So in short, I think they can't be in tension. They have to be together. You have to have strategies that get the most out of everyone, and in doing so, grow the economy too.
Who's responsible then for the quality impact assessment on government strategy around skills? If you've got a strategy which currently means that folk who can only learn part-time because of their caring responsibilities can't access courses, or indeed people are far away from the jobs market because of their circumstances, have not to get the wee courses that take them to the place where they're job ready. Who's responsible for a really honest equality impact assessment of policy decisions around this? Because I think that my own view is that, you know, you can understand in a world where there's lots of job ready people available for work, you might, this is an issue around, you might argue around Brexit. It's a no-brainer for the employer to choose a person that's work-ready. But if you've taken away the courses that get people to that point where they may be job-ready, are you denying people access to economic opportunities?
I think there's two things underlying that question. So one is almost who's responsible in the system as it stands, and then secondly, is that enough? Or, you know, is it doing well at that responsibility? So, you know, the government would be able to answer more fully, or the agencies of government. But in short, the people responsible, the systems responsible now, are through outcome agreements for college and university. So they do track gender, they do track gender segregation, they do track fair access by certain measures. And then over in the skills system, the SDS-funded skills system, they have equivalents, albeit not really outcome-focused. So they do track, for example, frameworks, modern apprenticeship frameworks that have been traditionally gender segregated to try and improve that. So that's the system as it stands, that's who's responsible as it stands. But that probably more important question, I think, is, as you've put, is it doing well enough? You know, are there things underneath there that are hidden? And I think positive destinations does potentially hide quite a lot within there. So it can look quite, well, it looks great, doesn't it, to have, I think it's 92% positive destinations out of FE qualifiers. But actually, underneath that, again, is any learning opportunity a positive destination? Is any job a positive destination? Within those, are the really good jobs, in inverted commas, going to certain groups, and are the, again, in inverted commas, bad jobs going to others? We don't track that as well as we could, I think. So moving away from positive destinations, becoming a bit more ambitious than that, I think, is a really important part of the work that we're trying to push over these next, well, over these three reports, really. And I think that would begin to get underneath what looks like a really positive picture, depending on how you look at it, to look at some of those inequalities that are hidden just now.
But are those who have, the colleges are meeting outcome agreements defined by policy, which one might regard as unequal in its approach. So the colleges are tracking gender inequality or whatever, in the context of a policy which says full-time courses rather than part-time courses, when part-time courses disproportionately might benefit women. Who are asking those questions? I mean, is it part of your role, do you think, to be looking at these questions further?
So there's almost an unlimited, infinite amount of questions we could ask, and I'd love to get onto some of that stuff. My own background before this was as part of it was as a commissioner on the Widening Access Commission. So it's an issue that is close to my interest, both professionally and personally. We don't at the moment have plans to look at it, because in essence everything we do needs to have a funder that's interested in, as a charity, in funding us to look at it. So we don't, albeit I'd love to. I think more generally, though, again, it's really back to the answer to the previous point, which is, are we getting almost a granular, you know, are we getting underneath some of these trends that look positive? So, yes, gender balance has dropped, but on the other hand, gender segregation is a focus and seems to be improving in part to the skill system. But the overall point might be missing some really, really important, much more detailed points underneath that, which I think you're hitting on.
Okay, thank you.
Gillian, you wanted to come in with that?
question that, because obviously the route to employment, retraining and acquiring skills is more diverse now, and modern apprenticeships play a big part in that now. There is a perception, though, I think, still in employers and maybe the wider public, that modern apprenticeships are just for school leavers. And was that something that you came across when you were speaking to employers? You know, because that is a route for older people as well into retraining.
Yes, so particularly with the advent of, for example, technical or graduate apprenticeships, they're focused on different parts of skill level, but also different age groups, therefore. The core modern apprenticeship route, though, is predominantly focused on those that are very early or pre-career. So the proportion of people that have had less than 6 months of working prior to coming into a modern apprenticeship is quite high. So we're opening up routes that are potentially there for people throughout their career, but actually it is still dominated by people that are either early or pre-career. So, you know, whether there's two approaches there, do we want to promote those, which I think we do, those routes to older people and to people that are mid-career? But also, the second question in my mind is whether the modern apprenticeship route can do that all by itself, or do we need something in addition to it that can focus on those very mid-career, older workers too. I think, again, it's back to doing both. We don't need to just do one or the other. The apprenticeship legislation in terms of pay makes it difficult for much older people in terms of the minimum wage for apprenticeships, which obviously is a reserve matter. Albeit, I think SDS have a real focus on a minimum wage more generally rather than employers paying the apprentices minimum wage. But modern apprenticeships are opening up to people beyond pre and early career. I'm not sure they can do it all by themselves. They're part of the picture, but I think we need something else in addition to that too.
Yeah, thank you.
Ruth?
Good morning.
Hiya.
I'd like to hear a little bit more about your recommendation around learners and employers co-designing the skills system. I think co-design and co-production are inherently sensible, but it's quite a challenging thing to achieve. You said in the report that the skills system was often seen as confusing for learners, and one of the challenges you mentioned is around promoting a kind of high skills business model, and I suppose getting employers to value skills. So just to hear some of your reflections on how we would meet that recommendation and those challenges.
So in terms of co-design, again, it's one of those ones that brings, principles right down to that micro, that local level. So how do we ensure that, to me, co-design allows us to meet that demand gap, as far as there is a demand gap, much more easily if employers are involved in designing courses, are involved and tested in terms of their demand for their workers to go on those courses, we can begin to narrow that demand gap, I would hope. For learners, I think we have to, in the skills, in the FE, in the non-university parts, non-HE parts of the system, get used to the idea that learners need to be able to shape their learning as much as those in school through Curriculum for Excellence and Principle have, and as much as those at university and college through sort of quality improvement and quality assurance and enhancement principles have. Because at the moment, I'm not sure that principle is embedded across FE and skills in the same way. So those are general reflections. In terms of specifically, I think getting, I mentioned a few international examples, but one from America is around what's called a career pathways approach. And in essence, what that does is sets out quite clearly for a number of careers, if not unlimited numbers of careers, the qualifications, the education, the experience that will allow you to progress either in educational terms or in career terms. And I think getting into that territory in Scotland could be a really interesting place. But the crucial element for that for me would be to ensure that the career pathways aren't just designed by the employers and by the sectors, but they have flexibility for the employee or the learner in order to bring their interests and their potential to it too. So in essence, you're bringing a little bit of that culture that's coming through Curriculum for Excellence and that's already there in the university side of things, or at least in theory is, into the FE and the skills side of things too.
Thank you.
Thanks. Okay, thank you very much.
There's no more questions. Excuse me. So I think that we'll just draw that session to a close. Can I thank you very much for your time and the very interesting responses, and particularly I think for the tantalising glimpses of your next report, which we were hoping to see in May, but it looks like it will be probably be June before we get the chance to see it. So thank you again for coming here today, and I'll suspend the public, that's the end of the public meeting, and I'll suspend for a few moments until the gallery clears. If all of you people could...